I am Tara Hitchcock, and you are watching Harkins Theaters Behind the Screens. It's actually starting to drizzle a little bit, which is not uncommon here in London. We are just outside of the Royal Albert Hall, a very special Behind the Screens. This is the site of the big premiere for No Time to Die just a few days ago, the 25th Bond film, the last, sadly, for actor Daniel Craig. And Harkins Behind the Screens had a chance to chat with the cast.
James, fate draws us back together.
Congratulations on this. Can you relate at all to what we're going through? Has there ever been a franchise or an actor or actress who said goodbye to their role that as a viewer or an audience member, you were legitimately bummed?
I don't know. I mean, that's I think thank you. I think, I mean, it's like, it's, yeah, like, I think there's a, I don't know. Listen, I had a really amazing thing offered to me 17 years ago now. Something that has changed my life in ways that I could not even imagine. But also, you know, an acting job, and I'm an actor, and I always sort of wanted to put something of my own into this, but also to tell a story. And, you know, I always thought of him as a very complicated, emotional human being. He kills people for a living. That's quite, you know, difficult one, but he loves people. He falls in love. He falls out of love. He does all these things. I'm a huge, big movie fan. I like the front row, popcorn, big drink. I want to be there and blown away. But I also want to be moved. I want to be affected by what I'm watching. I don't just want the flashbangs, although we have plenty of those.
Well, you accomplished it, because there are some great, moving, very moving moments in this.
I literally met my trainer with a rolly and a bacon sandwich. And I said, I want to change.
I just finished watching the Being James Bond. Man, I got choked up at that. And that was only 45 minutes long. And it reminded me, one of the greatest things about Bond, in my opinion, and this might seem silly, is the way you always kind of button the jacket after getting out of a car, after landing. It's the way you pull that off. And I'm curious, is there any mannerism or personality trait or something subtle about you, Daniel Craig, that's a direct result from you playing this guy for so many years?
Well, I tell you, the kind of buttoning the jacket and the sleeve shooting. Mm-hmm. My grandfather was a master tailor. So when I grew up, there was a lot of good tailoring in the house. He dressed beautifully and had cufflinks and tie pins. And just, I used to play with his, he had a box with all the kind of cufflinks and things in. I used to play with those. And I get a lot of those mannerisms from him. I felt that's, and I've been incredibly fortunate to wear some beautifully tailored suits they need a little fiddle occasionally. They got to be straightened. They got to be, you know, and it felt the right thing to do. The other way around, has he affected me? I don't know. I can't take him home though. I mean, you can imagine going home and me turning up as James Bond. I wouldn't get, you know, my family are, you know, they keep me in my place.
You're a kite dancing in a hurricane, Mr. Bond.
I know you've talked about the fact that you always wanted to direct possibly a Bond film. Was it everything you thought?
I don't think I could have ever imagined what the experience was like. I mean, I think from the outside, you know, it looks like, you know, it's cars and attractive women and, you know, crazy adventures and exotic locales. And it's so much more than that. Obviously, there's a lot of stress and pressure. But I think, you know, having it be a family-run operation makes it really unique in the world of, you know, these big films. And I think, you know, having Daniel there, who has had so much experience being Bond, was also really special. I mean, there was just so many things. I think it's kind of nice not to go into it with too many expectations.
It must be weird too. He's so involved in this franchise. Here you come. I mean, does he ever get in your face, or are you ever intimidated to offer up a suggestion when this is kind of his baby? I mean, what is that? How do you walk that fine line?
I mean, I think once you start working with people, you know, once you've like, you know, rolled up your sleeves and, you know, really broken some pencil tips as you're like getting into it, you feel very comfortable both ways, you know, saying what you think about things. And sometimes there's no time to be, you know, to pad things with niceness. And that's what's great about good collaborations is like, you can just be direct. And the main goal is to make a good story. And I think that's what it was like. We just, you know, I really defer to Daniel actually because of his experience in being Bond. It's very difficult, I think, to write dialogue for a character who's so silent. There's a lot going on inside that mind. So going back to Fleming was a big part of it. And just, you know, conversation with Daniel about, well, how do you think, you know, he would handle these situations, these scenarios, and then drive it from there.
Well, when all else fails, just give me a close-up of those blue eyes and I'm good with silence. I'll just stare at those eyes.
People sometimes think it's not real, and I can guarantee you it's real. Those aren't like special, you know, VFX eyes going on there.
I met your new 00. She's a disarming young woman.
You know, it's interesting. In the trailer, you hear James Bond talk about your character and say, she's a disarming young woman. What is the adjective that your friends would use to describe you?
Ooh, good question. Lately I've been told that I'm an octopus because I gesticulate a lot all the time. But outside of physicalities, I'd say that sparky. I'm always ready to like see what we're going to do next and how we can, you know, capitalize on moments and how we can make each other feel good. And I just want every moment to be as sparky as possible, so we're not wasting time, which I think is quite suitable for this film, actually.
I get why you shot him.
Yeah, well, everyone tries at least once.
You know, speaking of how your friends would describe you, when we spoke last time, I asked you who your real life BFF was, and you said a gal named Adama Anwar. So my question is, I'm assuming she's still your good friend, but my question is, you guys not only had to sit on secrets, you had to sit on secrets for an extra 18 months. Tell me at least your BFF knows exactly what's happening in this film.
You know what? Not exactly. It's to the point where I say some things, but I still hold some things back just so they can have the true cinema experience, because I don't want to ruin things. And a lot of friends will do the, just tell me, I'm going to forget it by the time it comes out. It'll be fine. I'll be in the zone. But I don't want that for them. I don't want them to always have that preempted moment where they're like, oh, I remember this from 2 years ago when he told me. I want them to be just as shocked as I would if I was watching them in the cinema. So yeah, they know some things, but they also are able to, yeah, be true to the moment.
His name is Sefin.
And what does he want?
Revenge.
My biggest question after seeing this film as it relates to your character is, when do you think the last time he got a hug was?
Oh. A hug? Yeah, no, very, 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 very early on in his life. He's had quite a difficult life, but, you know, there's something unique about him, about how, I don't know if he's the sensitivity might be there in certain scenes, but he's also able to remove himself from compassion and a moral compass in order to take down Bond and the world at large.
James Bond. We both eradicate people to make the world a better place.
I have to ask you, one of the creepiest things I thought about your villain, it wasn't the way he looked, it wasn't necessarily what he wore, although he could use a little Freddie Mercury color in his wardrobe, apparently. It was the cadence, your cadence, the way and the pacing of the speech. Was that all you?
Yes, you know, I think there's a lot of subtlety there, a lot of nuance. But if you look at him on screen, you'll see some movement back and forth. I just wanted everything to be just a little unusual, a little peculiar, a little unsettling, a little unpredictable. Those are all the things I always want to see when I see someone surprise me in a film. And I think we have those moments with Daniel.
Life is all about leaving something behind.
I'm always curious, who, in your opinion, is the best villain you've ever seen on screen? Because to me, a villain has to stay with you afterwards. Who's that for you?
I love Javier in Skyfall, but for me, watching him in No Country for Old Men was chilling. Chilling, yeah.
I'm with you.
Can't compete.
I need him in a rom-com so I can get past
this. Is it about time? Yeah, people are going to start saying that about me too, I think.
No, you to me will still always be Freddie Mercury, but that's just me because I feel like we shared that in person. Hey, congrats so much, Rami. It's great to see you.
Great to see you, Tara, always.
James, you don't know what this is.
I had the pleasure of chatting with you in Mexico City for Spectre, and I know probably like us, you thought that was Daniel's last film as Bond. So how did you find out? How did you get a phone call? Where were you when you found out, no, he's coming back and so are you?
Yeah, I remember where I was. I was in New York when they call me back. And it's very funny. Like, so Barbara called me, Barbara Broccoli, and she said, you know, Daniel is coming back this time, but it's a secret. And we want you back. So would you like to be part of the adventure? And I said, of course, yes.
Yeah.
But it was very funny because I was in the street in New York, and there was a paparazzi chasing Meg Ryan.
Oh no! Me.
I was on the phone, and they didn't like. They just like went, you know, in front of me, like they didn't. I mean, they recognized me or whatever, and they were like chasing, and I was like, it was very funny. So
they missed the biggest scoop of all. They literally missed the biggest scoop of all.
I was on the phone. Really? I'm in the next one? Yeah, and they were like, well, that was funny. That was a funny moment.
Okay.
Your relationship with Bond has lasted longer than any other Bond woman in the franchise. Yes. What's the key to keeping his interest for more than just one film?
It's because I think that James Bond has changed. Now he has become like a feminist, right? And that's thanks to Daniel, because it's really something that he, you know, it was also his will to create more interesting female characters. The relationship with women, you know, are more like
mature. He's matured is what he's
more
done.
Mature and more real. I think it's maybe the first time that he only has like one love affair, right? Mm-hmm. In No Time to Die, like in the previous ones he's always like he has those
he gets around, Leah, in the other ones he gets around, let's be honest. You know, how did you say goodbye to him on the film? I don't think you were there for his last day of actual shooting, because I think that was the stuff.
No, I wasn't there.
So how did you say goodbye? What was the last day of shooting for you like? You don't have to say what scene it was, but yeah. What was that like?
For me, my last day, it was really tough, I have to say.
Yeah.
Really tough. First of all, because of the scene, you know, and because mm-hmm. I knew that it was the end. It's a very intense emotionally speaking scene. It's been such an incredible experience, and on the not only because it was amazing to be on a set like James Bond, but also because it was an amazing human experience.
Let's just say Daniel Craig does a great job in his final outing as 007. Hey, don't forget to like us on Facebook, Harkins Theaters, for your movie news, promotions, and giveaways. And we will see you not outside in the rain, but inside at a Harkins Theater.